Our scripture reading today will be found in Mark, verses 30 to 32. Then the apostles gathered to Jesus and told him all things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And he said to them, "Come aside by yourself to a deserted place and rest a while." For there were many coming and going, and they did not even have time to eat. So they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves.
Father in heaven, in humbleness we ask for your spirit. We ask that you open the word for us and that you touch our hearts and help us become more and more like you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. So, for a while we have been through a subject called complete healing. And we have these banners coming to God's presence, receiving life abundantly. And I want to just give you a little introduction into our subject. As you know, last weekend we went in nature. It was a wonderful Sabbath. Connecting, relationships, fun, many people, too many people, and that's a good problem to have, more than we expected, and praise the Lord for it. It keeps growing every year. People get the message that is fun and is nice and is useful. But you know, people had to work to prepare it. And I did not organize it. Somebody else did. However, I had to do many things too. Preparing for the baptism, calling people, please get me this and please do that, going myself and getting whatever, phone calls. It was a lot of work, in top of visiting, in top of Bible studies, and then I had to call Rocco because I didn't have a tent. Rocco graciously allowed me to come and pick up his tent and use it. And then I had a visit, and then I had another appointment that I realized I was late for at 2:30, that Friday, so I called and canceled, and then when to leave, I realized, you know what? Today, I didn't even eat breakfast. And how did I know? I was kind of shaking. So somebody gave me a banana, and that was my breakfast and my lunch. And then, as I was trying to run to get in time there so I would be early as people arrive, I got there the third one. It was Chuck and Randy and Lois, and then me. And I thought the pastor should be first, you know, but I didn't manage. It was wonderful, except that I was too busy. The week before, we had a health seminar, if you remember Dr. Chester Clark. And he spoke Saturday night and Sunday morning. If you didn't attend the health, not the sermon, the health seminar, you would be blessed to ask for the DVDs or the CDs. You will get more benefit than you imagine. Well, to put together that seminar, to get everything, all the details that people don't know, all the details organized, I've been running the whole week. And besides that, nobody does my job if I don't do it. So phone calls and emails and prepare that. And, you know, I kind of forgot to eat again. And my wife said, "Honey, you don't have where to lose weight from. Just keep eating." And then to organize the evangelistic meetings and series and call and make sure that you have this and that and the church is ready and the departments, each one knows what to do, and we have the rope and we have the lights and we have the banners and we have the sign and we have that and we have that. And that day I got 45 emails and 68 phone calls, people asking, "Pastor, how should we do that, Pastor?" You know, all the details. And I forgot to eat again. So then being here, changing the lights from 7:30 a.m. to 11 p.m., it was kind of okay, I forgot again to eat. And a friend came, took me out, and bought me a vegetarian sub. And I ate that Subway, or what was it? It was not Sub, it was Jimmy John's, I believe. That was good. Moreover, when you are hungry, anything is good, you know? So let me ask you an honest question, and this is time for confession. Have you ever had a day like that, that you are so busy that you forget to eat? Yes or no? Confession time. How many of you have ever experienced a busy day? Uh-huh. So I'm not alone. I thought so. So a day that you don't even have time, if you eat, to chew the food. Like a dog, you just get it through, you know? Can you, when we live this type of lifestyles, can we really live a healthy, balanced life that we can really serve God and take care of our families and our health? Can we? Do we really serve God? Do we really do a good job when we do that? You live early in the morning, go to work, work hard, come late at home. When you get home, guess what? It's not over. It's a lot more to do. You have to clean, you have to cook, you have to wash, you have to fix, maintenance, this and that. And then you have emails and telephones. And you sure want to take a shower. If not, you know, you are sticky. You know how it is? So take a shower. Then you want some family time. Your children, they are not tired, never. So they want to jump on you, and you kind of, okay, I love you, but can you slow down? Let's just tell a story. And they are over the story age, you know. They want to do something, and you don't feel like doing something. You just want to get in the bed, legs up, read the news, watch the news, do nothing, kind of turn off everything. And then you need to spend time with your spouse, hopefully. Okay? And then you want to relax. When? That's a joke. When to relax? Jesus' disciples, though we think that they had nothing to do, life has always been the same. Nothing changes. People change. Problems are the same. Sins, challenges, temptations are the same. The disciples were facing the same challenge, a daily, crazy, busy schedule. They had days when they didn't have time to eat. I want you to open your Bibles in Mark chapter 6. That's the story that we will analyze today. And you'll find in that story, listen careful, Mark 6, we'll find in that story, listen careful, a problem, a complication to the problem, and the solution. What do we find there? Problem, complication, and solution. Okay? So, Mark 6, verse 30 to 32. And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all things that they have done and they have taught. And Jesus said to them, come apart in a secluded place and rest for a while. For there were many coming and going. They didn't even have time to eat. So they departed in a remote place, privately. So what is the picture here? Jesus sent them in their first missionary assignment. Jesus sent the 12, and they went out, and they did evangelism, and they gave Bible studies, and they preached, and they visited. And they cast out demons, and they lay hands and anointed and prayed for the sick and healed the sick. And they got people converted, saved into Jesus' kingdom. And they came back and they were so happy. Amazing ministry, isn't it? Jesus, we preached and you know, we have no school. We didn't go to the seminary. And you know, there were 70 people listening to me. And there were 100 and there were 12 and there were 5. And you know, I prayed for somebody sick and they got healed. Isn't that amazing? And Jesus, instead of getting excited, Jesus looks to them and says, you know what? You need time off. People are listening. Let's do it again. And Jesus says, nah, let's go. Take a break. Doesn't make much sense when you feel like going. And Jesus says, listen, slow down. And Peter says, listen, Lord, let's finish this project and then we slow down. When things settle down, when there is nothing to do, do you know when there is nothing to do? I tell you when. When things settle about 7 feet under the ground down, then things stop. Then you don't have to worry about anything because you are not able to. When you die, things slow down, believe me. But until then, they never do. Long ago, I told you a story. I was playing Monopoly with one of my close relatives. And they always beat me. I was never good at that game. And finally, in the same canasta, I was playing with our neighbors, and they always beat me. And I played one time with Peter and Dion, another game, I forgot the name, and they beat me. I said, that's a shame to beat the pastor, you know? But they beat me. So let's go back to the Monopoly story. So we played Monopoly, and we played and played and played and played, and they beat me again and again and again. And eventually, I was trying to save, and I was losing. And they told me the secret, you got to invest. So I got the secret. So after growing up, I was at camp meeting in Wisconsin, and I played Monopoly with a young kid. And now I was the master. And I invested everything. And the kid was saving. And I murdered him. I didn't kill him, don't worry. I just beat him badly, and I felt good. And I said, you got to invest. And the kid, okay. You know, he was beaten. So I met my relatives that used to beat me. And I said, you want to play again with me now? And she said, uh-huh. And I beat her. I said, finally, I got to master the game. I can even beat you. And you used to beat me. And I said, watch on the table. And she says, what? I said, I beat you. And she says, put it back in the box. I said, no, leave it there. She said, put it back in the box. No, I want people to see that I beat you. And she said, son, you don't get it. It all goes back in the box. We kind of forget that at the end of the game, it all, including ourselves, goes back in the box. It never slows down. So, the disciples had this problem, familiar problem. Mark uses the Greek verb, they didn't have time to eat, that it is an imperfect tense active voice. You know what that means? That was not one-time incident. That was an ongoing problem, continual, constant, daily challenge all their life. It was not for that time alone. It was every day. It's not, okay, we finish this project and then we slow down. You can fool yourself that way, but you know that's a lie. Because after you finish this project, even before you finish this project, you have two more projects and you got to do them. When you finish those two projects, you have another four. And that's how life is. And unless you intentionally take time to relax, you'll never do it before you go in the box. It was an ongoing problem. So the disciples were daily challenged to find even time to eat or family. Does this sound familiar? Your daily schedule 24/7, 365? Tough to find balance. And you don't do bad stuff. You do good stuff. But it's too much. I read on the internet about a father trying to spend some time with his 8-year-old son. How old? Eight. And the father says, son, should we have some father-son time together, like play a game or go biking? And the father would expect the son saying, whoa, yeah! Listen to the answer that I read. Daddy, I am booked this week, I'm sorry. Today, I have homework. Tomorrow, after I coming from school and homework, I have piano lessons. Tuesday, I have karate. Wednesday, I have volleyball. Thursday, I have piano again. Friday, I have tennis. Saturday, I have this and that, I forgot. Sunday afternoon, I have a little time. Let's schedule it for Sunday if nothing would show up in between. 8 years old? Give me a break. So, Jesus did not say to the disciples, finish what you do, and if you have a little time, come apart. The Greek verb that Jesus said there is anapao. This is an imperative, it's a command. Jesus forced, in Greek, Jesus actually compelled, forced them. You got to stop right now. Drop it. But we didn't, drop it. Jesus, people are waiting. Drop it. Jesus forced them. It's an imperative, it's an order, it's an active voice. He made them stop. And it can be translated in two ways. Listen carefully. Number one, stop right away from any movement or labor. Stop right away from any movement or labor, from worrying, from planning or activities. From any type of activities, just stop it. And the second way to translate it, calm down, keep quiet, stop worrying, stop your mind from being anxious, be patient, expect wisdom and strength and peace from above. Isn't that powerful? Two ways. Number one, stop from any movement or labor or planning or activities. Number two, stop from worrying, be calm, stop from being anxious. Expect wisdom and peace from above. So listen carefully. I don't have to convince you today that we have a problem. But there is something else. We have a problem, but we have a complication to the problem. You remember? This is what happened in our story. Excuse me. Jesus stopped them. And Jesus said, let's go to a private place that we can rest a little. And the disciples, okay, we got it. They get in the boat and they cross the lake. And guess what happened? Read in your Bibles the next verse. People saw Jesus and the disciples getting in the boat, and people started, the masses, the living crowd, started to run on the shore around the lake. And by the time they got there, guess who was waiting? Let me explain, church. We don't have just a problem. We have an added complication. When you try to take time off, guess what? Your work follows you home. Follows you in nature. Your work follows you wherever you go. Have you seen that in your life ever? The disciples did. An added complication. Nothing new to us. It's in Mark 6, verse 30 to 33. People started to run from all cities around and came there waiting for him. When you try to take time from your hectic, crazy schedule, your work follows you. Don't you ever take work from work at home? Is it because you are unable to finish? You are slow? They should put you in a slower group? Or is it because Satan is trying to keep us in bondage that we never get time for God, never for family, never for rest? Probably. So, the disciples could see the crowd running around, the mass of needy humanity growing by the minute, waiting for them. When they finally sigh and say, we can relax, they don't even have time to eat or sit down, because people are waiting for them. We don't only have a problem, we have a complication. Our society has created, has developed 1,000 ways for the world to follow you home, that you don't have a family and you don't have a life. Our society has created computers and cell phones. Computers and cell phones were supposed to make our life easier. In fact, when they invented computers, somebody spoke to the Congress and said, 25 years from now, we will drop the work from 40 hours a week to 20 hours a week, and we don't know what to do with the leisure time. Listen, do you have that problem, not knowing what to do with the leisure time? In fact, computers added to our problems and to our stress, and cell phones did too. You know, cell phones are a wonderful thing, but you know what? They don't do anything good to our life. I know some people that they are, again, opposed to cell phones. Oh, I have messages. And I have emails. Should I answer? Should I check them? No? Okay. Stay there. 1 second. Just 1 second. Hello? Oh, yes, how are you doing? Huh? You have a problem? Oh, yeah, I'm listening. Ah, your finger is hurting you. No, I don't know a doctor. I mean, you can search for a doctor. You don't need my help. Okay. I am during the sermon. Can I? It's not a good time. Okay. God bless you. Okay, bye. I don't even have time to preach my sermon now. My stocks, wait a second. Ooh, the stocks went up. It says that I have to act right now. If not, I lose. Just takes 3 minutes. Done. I have 3 messages. Done. Oh, 5 emails. You get the picture? I think you do, don't you? I'm going to turn it off. Throw it away. I don't need a cell phone. It's buzzing. Is it my heart fibrillating from all the stress or the cell phone? Church, this happens all the time. Soon, they are going to invent waterproof cell phones that you can take in the shower. Yeah, they will do that to you. You just allow them and they are going to kill you. Waterproof cell phones that you can take in the shower. Business opportunities, messages, emails, no peace. Satan loves that. Do you ever know anymore what it means to have time with family? Do you know what it means to have time with God? Do you know what it means to slow down? When do you do that? How many times a day? Okay, how many times a week? Let's be gracious here. How many times a week you literally turn everything off? Believe me, you are not going to save the world. Things can wait. How many times you turn everything off and go alone with God, and go alone with your kids, and go alone with your spouse, and enjoy some time? How many times do you do that? Okay, cell phone, I forgot where I was in the sermon. I didn't forget. We had a problem, our crazy schedule. We had a complication. What is that? Our work follows us at home. Isn't it? But the Bible talks about a solution. Let's read it. If we go on from Mark 6, verse 34 on, it's wonderful. Jesus saw the people and Jesus was moved with compassion. This is a wonderful picture of our wonderful Savior. And I know people misuse this verse. I have heard it many times in our church. Oh, don't you see the people in need? Don't you see the people? We got to do something. That's a wrong way to misuse the verse. People always are in need, and you'll never manage to help them, because the more you do, the more it comes, the more it is. Too much to do, you'll never finish. That's a wrong way to abuse your body, your family, and to abuse the Bible. There is nowhere in this story in the Bible that Jesus asked them to work 24/7. In fact, Jesus asked them to drop everything, force them, because they will not get it. And Jesus asked them to take a break. So, I want you to listen to a quotation from the book Desire of Ages, chapter 38. Come, rest a while. Page 361. Though Jesus could do miracles, and though he could ask the disciples to work all the time, there was plenty of work. Though he empowered them to do miracles too, he knew that they would be burned out. He directed his tired servants to go apart into the country in a remote place and rest. He did not urge upon them the necessity of ceaseless toil. On the contrary, he wanted them periodically to stop and rest. Isn't that a powerful quotation? Perhaps Jesus was hoping that they will alone be mature enough to realize that if you die, you don't help anybody. That they would rest, but it didn't happen. So unfortunately, because it didn't happen, because they didn't just work all the time, they seemed to find an excuse for their work all the time, an explanation for what they do, Jesus had to force them to take time off. And listen, they didn't have a good attitude. They are not positive. They are not doing a good job. Because when they got tired, they started to have a short fuse. If you keep reading, they go to the next village and they ask God to bring fire from heaven and ruin, burn the whole village. They also want to put Jesus as a king on this world. So let me explain. When you are fresh, rested, you can think straight. But when you are tired, it's a lot easier to do mistakes and have a short fuse and explode and do bad stuff. You follow me? They were tired, so they had a bad attitude. They were too stressed to think straight. You follow me? Being tired, hungry, stressed, their attitude, says the quotation, was not positive. Plus, if you think about it, patience, it's a gift from the Holy Spirit. Kindness, wisdom, they all come from God. If you have no time with God, don't expect to have the good gifts. You follow me? But today, I want us to learn from this story how to live a healthy lifestyle. How to quit those problems that you don't even have time to eat, too much to do, the complications when the work follows you wherever you go, and what is the solution? Mark 6:45. This is important. 45 to 46. And Jesus constrained the disciples to get into the boat and send people away. Oh, he sent people away. Jesus being rude? I don't think so. Okay. And then listen carefully now. Everybody listening. He departed into the mountain to pray alone. What did Jesus do? He departed into the mountain to pray alone, says in my translation. The solution to our problem and to our complications is to follow Jesus' example. Jesus went to the mountain to have time out alone with God. Upper room. Close the door behind you. You and God alone. You may say, Pastor, this is kind of a simple solution. Well, just wait. Just stay with me. Psalm 121, verse 1. I lift my eyes to the mountain from where will my help come. Where is your help coming from? What is the mountain there? There is a question for you. What did Jesus do in that time? What did he do? I'm going to suggest three things. How many? Number one. Jesus received strength from just being in God's presence. Doing nothing. Just being with God. I could give you Bible verses that say that you give me strength. I run to you and you give me strength. I can give you examples and stories from the Bible, quotations from the spirit of prophecy. For just being in God's presence, you receive strength. Number one, Jesus received spiritual recharging strength from just being in God's presence. Sometimes you may say, Pastor, isn't God's presence with us all the time? Yes. But sometimes we can be so inundated by our problems and worries that we don't sense God's presence. And secondly, that we don't allow him to work in our heart, in our mind. Am I speaking the truth? Psalm 46, verse 10. Be still and know that I am God. The verb still, be still, is Rapha. That doesn't mean to be quiet. It means, listen, translated from Hebrew, calm down, relax, let worries and anxiety go. When you go before God, let worries go. In God's presence, calm down. You are not going to fix the problems in that moment. Just take time and calm down. Just spend time with him. Just calm down. That's Rapha. Be still. And know that I am God. The verb know is not the verb to know. It's yada that is used when God told Adam and Eve, go and sleep together. Yada. That means calm down in God's presence and have an intimate relationship with God. Drop everything. Forget everything. Get time to love God and let Him love you. Isn't that powerful, church? When you go into God's presence, let worries go. Stop worrying. Anxiety, planning, thinking, out. And get time for relationship. Get time to know Him. Let Him love you. Let Him help you. That's where it says in Desire of Ages, Jesus got strength. That's where Jesus got recharging. That's where Jesus got assurance. That's the reason we miss these things badly. We are always drained because recharging comes from God and God alone. When you go into God's presence, calm down and don't focus on problems. Don't even pray for problems. First, focus on Him. Just be in His presence. Let things go. In that time, Jesus may have praised God. Jesus may have sung songs, may have repeated the words of the prophets, may have repeated God's promises that would give you strength, may have focused on God and His character and His love and His creation. May have just talked to God, time one-to-one, communion. He may have experienced what David wrote in Psalm 16, verse 11. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. So what is number one? Jesus received what? Strength. Number two, Jesus rested physically. He actually rested. I know some folks that they think it's a sin to fall asleep when you study or when you pray. I think it's a blessing. I'm sorry, but I mean, if you pray so long that you eventually fall asleep, that's wonderful. Now listen, if you are praying during my sermon, now it's a good time to look left and right and nudge whoever is taking a nap. That's wrong. You may be sleep deprived. Sleep deprivation, you know? That's wrong. I know somebody, when I was in Norway in school, his name is Tiago. He was a classmate. His father is a pastor in Portugal. And his father was giving a sermon. And in Portugal, like in Romania, when you preach, there are two elders, kind of bodyguards, staying there during the sermon. And one would announce the opening song and say the opening prayer. The other one would announce the closing song and say the closing prayer. And they stay there. One of them was Elder Lazarus. That was his name. But he was so tired that he fell asleep during the sermon. And the pastor was preaching on Lazarus. And he got to the point that Lazarus died. And Jesus went to the tomb. And Jesus said, Lazarus, wake up! And the guy, okay, in Jesus' name, we close the worship service with song number. And he says, no, not you. Lazarus from the story, you can sit down. If you are so tired that you take a nap during church or you cannot even go to church, there's something wrong in that picture. But there is nothing wrong to actually spend time with God and then fall asleep into God's arms as a child would fall asleep into the mother or the father's arms. You follow me? It says right in the Bible, Psalm 139, verse 17, Psalm 63, verse 6, David was talking to God after his evening prayer. He was still there talking to God in his bed. It says in Hebrew translation, he says, I lay in my bed in your presence and I meditate on you. He was talking to God, meditating to God's love, God's creation, God's grace. Now he says, I fall asleep while thinking about you in Hebrew. There is nothing wrong to think about God and you fall asleep. And then very nice, David says in the same two chapters in Psalm, During the watches of the night, I wake up and you are there by my bed. Isn't that a wonderful picture? And then he says, in the morning when I wake up, you are still there by my side. What a picture. What a wonderful Savior. God is not angry if you think about him until you fall asleep. And if you wake up during the night, that you think about him more. And when you wake up in the morning, you think about him more. Isn't that a nice way to go to sleep? Isn't that a nice, peaceful way that you can get rest and refreshment? So Jesus probably went to the mountain, and after he prayed, he took a nap. And that's okay. He said, Lord, Father, now it's time for a nap. See you when I wake up. Isn't that nice? So number one, he received strength. Number two, he got physical rest. But there is a third ingredient. Listen carefully. By the way, when you go home today, you are allowed to take a nap in the afternoon. There is nothing wrong to sleep on Sabbath as long as you come to church. But make sure that your nap is not too long and you come tonight to the Revelation seminar, okay? There is a third ingredient. Jesus, it says there, that received the plan. Look in Desire of Ages, and I'm going to show you Bible verses. Received the plan from the Father. Jesus received the agenda, received instruction. We have this problem. We don't know when to say, when to keep quiet, what to say. We don't know when to engage, when to disengage, when to do and when to wait, and how long to wait. We need instruction from the Lord. We need to know what to say, what not to say, when to say it, when to wait. We need advice. Jesus received wisdom from the Father. What to do, what not to do, when to do it. Don't we need that? Oh, badly. We mess up so many times. We talk when we should keep quiet. We keep quiet when we should talk. We don't say what we should say. We don't do what we should do. And we do what we should not do. And we do them in a wrong time. Jesus received instruction and wisdom. You will learn when to engage and disengage when you go into God's presence. We need that, don't we? Mark 1, 35 to 37, a different occasion. In the morning, Jesus rose up way before day, and he went out and he departed in a solitary place and prayed. I imagine Simon, Peter, waiting anxiously. I mean, Jesus goes to the mountain to pray, and people are waiting, and Simon is kind of shuffling and impatient. Lord, close that long prayer. People are waiting. Don't you care? And Jesus says, okay, I finish my prayer. The Father told me what to do. And what did Jesus say next? You go. You, to the crowds, go. We go to the next village. Don't you care? These people came. They have needs. And Jesus says, no, it's time for us to move on. Is Jesus cruel? Doesn't he care for the crowds that came? Jesus received advice, wisdom from the Father. You can do so much for some people, and after that, they need to do a little for themselves too. You cannot just give them the food and digest and chew the food for them. If possible, swallow the food for them. You follow me? It's time to move on. There are others in the next village who need your help. Leave them alone. We never know when to stop, when to start. We never know when to move on. In God's presence, we receive that type of wisdom that we don't do mistakes. How did Jesus respond? He said, let us go to the next towns that we may preach there too, because for this I came. Between this place and that place, they had a few days. If you look into the Bible, it was a walk of about 2 days. They had a few days of rest, actually. Secondly, between this place and that place, they could talk, pray, think. If we don't learn this lesson, We will be burned out and die young. Where to learn this lesson? Then in God's presence. So church, number one, Jesus received strength. Number two, he rested. Number three, he received wisdom. Jesus wants you to enjoy a healthy life. We live in a schedule, in a day, in a world where our schedule is crazy, 24/7, 365. And besides the problem, we have the complication, but Jesus gives us the solution. Take time to go on the mountain. Take time to go in your prayer room, you and God alone. There you receive strength. There you rest. And there you receive advice, instruction. We have talked about physical health, emotional health. We have talked about spiritual health. We have talked about healthy lifestyles. We have to talk more next week about healthy relationships, healthy finances, and so on. Do not miss any of the sermons. If you missed one, ask for the DVDs. You can ask for the whole series. Don't miss one. But remember for today that if you want to follow Jesus, you need to live a balanced life. In a world where everybody goes crazy, you cannot help them if you don't live a balanced life, if you are not an example. So I invite you today, after your power nap, to come for evangelism tonight, for Revelation Seminar. And right now, if there is anybody here or watching on the website and that would sense the need for God to help him or her, to help you live a healthy, balanced lifestyle, I would like you to raise your hand up. I'm going to raise my hand too, saying that I need to learn to do that myself. And as you raise your hands, if you sense that God, that you need God to help you to live a healthy, balanced lifestyle, raise your hand. As you raise your hand, I'm going to pray for you. Father in heaven, you know our lives and you know our needs and you love us. In this world where Satan wants us to be in bondage, to do, to worry and never slow down, in this world, we pray that you help us set time, schedule intentionally time aside for relationship with you, where we can receive strength and rest and wisdom and power and faith, where we can be refreshed, where we can be recharged. We pray that you also help us spend time with our families, and we pray that you help us this way become a real blessing for the people who need to learn this around us. We pray that you answer our prayer and help us all. And we pray in Jesus' merits. Thank you so much. We love you and we praise you. Amen.